nothing that could change. Your love, there's no one that could tame it. This crazy love, oh, what could separate us from your love? Your love, this crazy love. Thank you. nothing that can change. Your love, there's no one that can tame it. This crazy love, oh, what could separate us from your love, this crazy love.
Welcome everyone. We want to welcome every one of us to another session in this ongoing conversation on the glory of God. Welcome. We hope you've been having a great time. And a great week already. Yes. Good evening. Good evening to you. It's good to see us. It's good to see you. It's good to see everyone again. Welcome. All right, so this conversation has been going on now for we're in the fourth week of this ongoing conversation on the glory of God. So very quickly, we will be picking up from where we left off. Now, if you noticed, what we've been doing is, by having this conversation, we have been looking at some sort of tracing out, you know, different understandings, you know, as to what the glory of God is, you know, different, you know, as it were, concept, you know, of what the glory of God is. And also, by the Spirit of God, we also have been tracing out, you know, layers of operations, you know, of the glory of God. Now, from the two sessions that we have held now, we began to look at something from the book of John about the glory of God. What, you know, Jesus, in the reference made to Jesus, of what he begins to say and show, you know, about what the glory of God is. Now, the last scripture we looked at in the from the last session is from chapter 17 of John. All right, I want us to begin from there and push further from chapter 17 of John. All right, he says that 17 of John is the prayer of Jesus. From verse 24, we are looked at 24. You know, we're going to look at it again. From verse 24, he says, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. That they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Now, we understand that this is in the New Testament, part of the Bible. So that means that the word glory here, you know, as used in the Greek, all right, is the Greek word doxa, all right, which is the word for glory in the Greek language. All right, we understand that the Hebrew word for glory, as used in the Old Testament, in a part of the Bible, is the word kabod. All right, so, but in the Greek, all right, language with which the New Testament is written is the word doxa. So it doesn't matter the language, pretty much the same thing. So he says that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. Now, Jesus says something very important here, all right? He defines, or he captures for us, what our call is, what we are called to do, what we are, you know, designed to do. Now, he says that those whom you have given me, my intent, Father, my desire, Father, is that they be with me where I am. I worked a little bit around that in the last two, you know, sessions that we had. It says that they may be with me where I am. All right, we talked about where I am. Then it says that they may behold my glory, that they may behold my glory. So Jesus is letting us know in his prayer here that this is the lot of everyone. This is the lot of every child of his. This is the lot of every saint, everyone who comes under his lordship. All right. This is the portion. This is the call of every child of his, you know, every child of God that, you know, comes into relationship with the Father, all right, through him. All right. So he says that we all have a call to behold his glory. You see, we all have a call to behold his glory. Now we'll come back to that. Now it says that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. Now, we remember that in chapter 12 of the book of Numbers, all right, an interesting statement was made of Moses, which is referenced and quoted in the book of Hebrews chapter 3, all right, where Moses is spoken of as being a servant, all right, in the house, all right, as a type of that which was to be spoken of, all right. Now, we see Moses in his conversation with the Lord in chapter 33 of Numbers. In Numbers 33, we see in Moses' conversation how that he said to the Lord, he expressed his desire to see the glory of God, all right? He said to the Lord, if truly I have found favor before you, show me your glory. Now, to further help us understand what Moses meant, all right, after that, it was broken down to let us know that what Moses was asking for was the face of God. You see, was the face of God, all right, to which God, you know, seemed to have responded that it was impossible, all right, for anyone to see his glory. Now, that is what the literal text suggests, because it is said that God said, you know, no one can see my face and live, all right? He said, but because you found favor, you found grace before me, he said, don't worry, there's a side by me I'm going to show you, all right? But there are teaching series we've done in the past where we looked very closely at what actually transpired there, right? And we have at different times referenced, you know, this series. Now, we had said that what God said to Moses was that, or what Moses had desired to see was the before of God. You see, because the word for face, all right, in that book of Numbers, chapter 33, is the word used in the Hebrew for face, which is the word panim, all right? But it actually was used there as a parable, because what Moses was asking for wasn't just the face of someone's head. He was asking for, you know, the state. Moses desired to see the state of God's existence, you see, before anything was created. You see, Moses was asking to see the state. You see, now it's important to understand that because, you know, going forward from chapter 3 of the book of Numbers, right, into the rest of the other portions, you know, chapters and verses and books of the Old Testament scripture, we will see that the word panim, all right, continues to be used. All right, there were several instances in the Old Testament where, you know, the face of God, you know, where people desired this, his face, where people looked at his face was used. You see, and in none of those different, you know, portions of scripture was anyone rejected, you know, as it were, you know, like Moses, from seeing the face of God. But why was it different in Moses' case? It was because even though it was the same Hebrew word used, all right, what Moses desired was completely different. Moses desired to see the state, you see, to see the state of the existence of God, you see, the state of, you know, the character of God before the first act of creation. You see, to which God responded, no one can see my face and live. Now, we've also dealt with that in previous teachings, all right? Now, what that means is not that the person would die, as it were. It is that the person would be transformed. You see, the person would change state. You see, to see the state of God, all right, before the creation of anything would mean that the person would have to change state. It is the changing of state that is referred to there as, you know, not seeing his face and live, you know, continuing to live. So it's not physical death. You see, it is not physical death. Maybe we should read it. Let's quickly look at this again. We'll come back to John chapter 17. So quickly, the book of Exodus 33. Exodus chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. Now, before we go straight to verse 18, I want us to see verse 11. Look at verse 11 of the same chapter. All right. Maybe we should see from verse 9. It says, and it came to pass as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door. And all the people rose up and worshipped, every man in his tent door. Verse 11. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face. You see that? The Lord spake unto Moses face to face. Now, the word face to face there is the same word, panim. All right? So, the Lord spoke to Moses panim to panim. All right? Face to face. All right? As a man speaketh unto his friend, and he turned again into the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. Now, quickly go to verse 18. Okay, let's see from verse 17. It is, and the Lord said unto Moses, I will do this thing also that thou hast spoken, for thou hast found favor in my sight, and I know thee by name. And quickly, Moses leveraged on that, verse 18. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Now, the word glory there is the word kabod. He says, show me thy glory. So you're wondering, show me your glory. All right. Just a few verses before, it was said that the glory of God descended. You see, descended on the tabernacle when Moses entered. So what other glory is Moses talking about? Now, even though it's the same word used here and there, all right, it was a different experience. You see, so that's why I was saying that from the very beginning, that the glory isn't just a cloudy, substance or manifestation. Because Moses was supposedly in the glory and he was asking for the glory here. He said, verse 18, and he said, I beseech thee, show me your glory. He was in the glory, supposedly, in the cloud, and he's asking to see the glory. You see, he was in the glory, and here he was asking the Lord, all right, to have his glory shown to him. All right, say, show me thy glory. Now, God knew what he was talking about, all right? Verse 19, and he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will be, on whom I will show mercy. Verse 20, and he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. Isn't it interesting? Verse 11, he says that God spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks with his friend. And here, the scripture is saying, God says that no man can see my face and live. Now, this is God's response to Moses' request to see his glory. So, the glory Moses was asking for isn't just the bright cloud, you know, isn't just, no. Isn't just the manifestation, you see, that the priest, that the priest in 2 Chronicles chapter 5 saw. Moses was asking for something else, something very, very specific, all right, that God, you know, to which God responded to and said, no one can see that thing you're asking for. You see, so what glory was Moses asking for? What is Moses asking for here that is referred to or that is also glory? Moses wasn't asking for a manifestation, all right? Moses was asking for, all right, fellowship with the state of God. Moses was asking for interactions with the state of God before the creation of anything. You see, this state of God cannot be referred to as a cloud. It can be referred to as, you know, the different, you know, manifestations, you know, that is used to describe the or characterize the glory of God. And the teachings that we've done in the past, where we explained this, all right, and talked about what was it Moses asked for, all right, and what is the significance of the response of the Lord when he says, no one can see my face and live. No man, he says, can see me and live. Now, if you go back to chapter 17 of John, all right, even though it's not in the same language, all right? It's not the same language, all right? We understand that it's the same thing, all right? It's the same thing Jesus is referring to here, which he says the Father had given to him. Verse 24 again, it says, Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. You see, that they may behold my glory. That they may behold my glory. They may behold my glory. That they may behold my glory. You see, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. So this glory, which Jesus, all right, says had been given to him, all right, is the glory, is the fact that Jesus was referring to the state of God before the creation of all things as his. Do you understand that? This glory Jesus is referring to here isn't a cloud, isn't a light, isn't, you know, nothing. It's a state. He's speaking of the state of divinity before the creation of all things as his. You see, so Jesus, all right, here went a little bit farther than Moses. Moses desired to see, desired to have an experience of what this state was about. But here Jesus is saying, what this state is mine. You see, Jesus wasn't expressing rather the desire to see this state. Rather, he was speaking of being in possession of this state. This is what Jesus is referring to. He has glory. He says that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. You see, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. He said, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. You see, that sheds more light on what this glory is. You see, he's talking about that which was before the setting up of all things. That's the word foundation. Before the setting up, before the creation of all things. So Jesus, long before he went to the cross, or shortly before he went to the cross, all right, defined, all right, what will become our privilege. All right, he made known what will become available to us when he says that we will be called, or we are called, all right, to be where he is. We talked about that two conversations back. All right, it is that the people you have given to me may be with me where I am. You see, that they may be with me where I am. So being with him where he is, which we describe as what? The state, you see, of fellowship. You see, the state of interactions, or the state of fellowship that we have with the Father, all right? That's what it's talking about, not a place, as it were, not a physical geographic place, all right? It's a place and state of fellowship, all right? A state and a place of divine union is what is meant here as where I am. So this state and place of divine union, all right, becomes the springboard, becomes the platform, becomes the foundation for what? Beholding his glory. Of beholding his glory. Oh, glory to God. This is what Moses was asking for. Because Moses made this request, you remember, while he was in the middle of a bright cloud. The scripture says that into the tabernacle he had entered, the pillar of cloud had descended. He was in the place of the manifestation of the presence of God, all right, of what the Jews call the glory of God. Now, what the Jews call the glory of God was in that cloud, was that cloud into which Moses had gone. And here was Moses in the cloud asking to see the glory of God, asking for the Father to show him his glory. Can you imagine that? Folks out there, all right, who on seeing the cloud went on their knees and worshiped. All right, they worshiped because in their minds, this was the glory of God. All right, this is what was going on out there. But in that cloud, in that manifestation, here was Moses, all right, asking to see the glory of God. Asking to see the glory, the face of God. Can you see that? Levels of intelligence. You see, levels of intelligence, levels of spiritual understanding. On the level of spiritual understanding of the people, this cloud, you see, this brightness is the glory of God. While on the level of spiritual understanding, all right, of Moses, all right, there was something else. Something else beyond brightness. Something else beyond light. See, something else beyond a cloud that Moses understood to be the glory of God. So that one cannot be seen. Cannot be seen. That is the one Jesus referred to here as his glory. You see, that you and I have been called to behold. You and I have been called to behold. Glory to God. So he went on and says, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. In this statement Jesus made here, he just ties it all up. See, so what he is referring to here, all right, both as where he is, all right, and his glory, all right, is beyond, all right, is well before the setting up of all things. You see, is well beyond the setting of all things. Now, if we begin to look at some of the things we have shared, all right, in relation to the glory of God within the last couple of weeks, you know, we will begin to see that there is a need to become functional. There is a need to become functional, you see, in our interactions with the person of God. You see, our interactions with the person of God, you see, as represented, as embodied, as manifested, all right, in Jesus. You see, because if we look at the many references that we have looked at within the last couple of weeks, within the last 3 weeks, you know, from the scriptures, in the scriptures rather, in relation to the understanding and the interactions that, you know, folks in the scriptures had demonstrated and displayed, all right, in relation to the glory of God, you will see that these folks, not minding the different levels of understanding, the different levels of interactions, or like I said earlier, the different levels of intelligence they had in relation to the glory, we would see that they were functional. They could interact. They could relate, all right, with what the glory of God was to them, all right, at their different levels. In other words, they were functional. You see, because if you look at this verse here in 17 of John, verse 24, when Jesus says that we are called to behold. Now, the word behold, all right, is suggestive of a functional disposition or a functional interaction. All right. The word, there's a way you look at the scripture, and all you would see there will be limited to something that you confess, you affirm, you know. But what Jesus is saying here, when he uses the word behold, all right, goes beyond something that you know or I know in our heads, all right. He uses the word behold to define a functional disposition, a functional interactive disposition. Beholding the glory of God is functional. Is the word behold is active, all right? It defines an active position. You see, the word behold is active, because if you look at the Old Testament, all right, many of the folks who interacted with the glory of God at different levels, all right, did that from a functional interactive position. You see, their knowledge of the glory of God came from a functional interactive position. Look at the many times in the previous series where we looked at the priest, all right? How that the priest had an understanding, an interactive understanding, all right, of what the glory of God was. Now, so which means that for us who have the privilege, who are in that state, you see, of interactions with the glory of God, all right, must ourselves be functional. We must be functional. Hence why the word behold is used. The word behold is used here to capture our functional interactive position. You see, our functional interactive position. Now, once again, if you look at Exodus 33 that we read earlier, all right, where from verse 11, he speaks of Moses, all right, you know, he speaks of God rather, speaking or talking to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend. You see, face to face as a man speaks to his friend. Now, you would remember that that's not the first time, you know, God was speaking of Moses like that. Now, we see that also in Numbers, all right? Let's quickly look at Exodus again, 33, then we'll go to Numbers 12. Exodus 33, once again, Exodus 33, all right? Exodus 33, verse 11 again, it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses face to face, all right? The Lord spake unto Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend. You see, now face to face from the Hebrew language is the word panim. All right. Now quickly go to Numbers chapter 12. Now, this was when the Lord began to rebuke Miriam and Aaron. All right. Let's see from verse 5. It says, and the Lord came down in the pillar of the cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both came forth. And he said, hear now my words, if there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream. Verse 7, my servant Moses is not so. Who is faithful in all my house? With him will I speak mouth to mouth. All right? With him will I speak mouth to mouth. Now, the Hebrew word here is peh. All right? Is peh. Peh is the Hebrew word for mouth. All right? But it's not just the word for mouth alone. It's also the word used for opening. All right? The word peh is also used for opening. See, is also used for opening, that which opens up, or the extremity, all right, opening, or that which opens up, all right, or the orifice, or the opening of a well, of a river. So the mouth-to-mouth is a phrase used here, you know, in a parable context. So God wasn't speaking literally of the mouth that is on your face, all right? The same way, in chapter 33 of Numbers, all right, what the scripture says is face to face, that God speaks to Moses or spoke to Moses face to face. The Hebrew word there is panim. Now, the word panim there isn't just the face, all right, that is on your head. All right, so mouth to mouth, face to face, all right, are some kind of parable used to describe the nature and character of Moses' interaction with God. You see, so face-to-face, mouth-to-mouth basically mean the same thing. It's the same thing that is being talked about, all right? Even though it's different Hebrew word, all right? Face-to-face is panim, panim to panim, all right? Mouth-to-mouth is pair to pair, P-H. But it's the same thing that is intended. It's the same thing that is communicated. All right? So what actually is being talked about is the fact that Moses had a level of interaction with God, all right, via the gates. That is why it is mouth to mouth, via the gates, the point of openings of his being. So Moses was not interacting with God via his prophetic giftings. You see, Moses was not using the prophetic giftings as an interface to receive from God or to interact with God. Moses actually went beyond, all right? The character of his interactions with God went beyond prophetic operations. That was what God, or that is what God is saying here in Numbers 12. All right? He says, if there is a prophet amongst you, all right? He said, I, the Lord, will speak to him in visions and in dreams. He said, but that's not the way I speak with Moses. All right? Why? Moses has found a better way of interacting with me. Moses has found a superior way. That's basically what God is saying. Mouth to mouth. You see, that is, Moses was using the interface of the opening of his gates. He wasn't using the prophetic gift as an interface to interact with God. He was using his gift. See, that is why Moses is said here, verse 7, he is called a servant, all right, who is faithful in all his house. Now, look at the book of Hebrews. Look at how the book of Hebrews, you know, shed a little bit more light on that statement. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. All right. From verse 2. Now, speaking of Jesus, from verse 1, speaking of Jesus, who is the apostle and high priest of our profession, verse 2 says, who was faithful, Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. You see? So he references that statement, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Verse 3, he said, for this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who had built the house had more honor than the house. He said, for every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. Verse 5, and Moses verily was faithful. He references it again. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant. He says, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. So you see, Moses actually saw into that which was coming. Moses actually saw into the substance that everything that they were doing was a type of. All right? He saw into that which everything that they were doing was a type of. He saw into the substance and dared. Moses dared. He dared to reach for it. You see, Moses dared to reach for it. It was his attempt, all right? It was his attempt to reach for that that made him go beyond the prophetic giftings, all right, existing as interface with which to communicate with God. You see, it was Moses' audacity, all right, to reach for the substance that all that they were doing was a type of, all right, that made him break beyond, you see, the interfaces of prophetic giftings. So what God was saying in Numbers 12 isn't something Moses was enjoying, all right, as a privilege. It wasn't that God was dealing with Moses, you know, on a pedestal. No, it was the result of Moses' audacity. It wasn't something that God gave to Moses on a platter of gold. It was rather something that Moses broke into. It was something that Moses entered into, not minding the fact that that reality, all right, within the current, you know, paraphernalia of all that they were doing wasn't available. It wasn't available. It was far removed from the things they were doing. All that they were doing were all paraphernalia that were a type, all right, of that which was to come. You see, so Moses refused to function in that which was a type. All right? Moses reached beyond that which was a type. That was the reason why in 33 of Numbers, Moses dared to desire and to voice out his desire of wanting to see the before of God. You see, when he said, if truly I have found glory in your sight, show me your face. You see, show me your state before creation. How did he even know of such a state? How did he even know? Glory to God. So if you come back to chapter 17 of John, Jesus says, my desire, dear Father, is to have those whom you have given to me, all right, to be me where I am. Now, we talked about that in the previous sessions. We're going to tie up some of these things later. That they will be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory that you have given to me. So we are looking at the word behold. Now, the word behold, or rather, what Jesus is saying here, all right, captures an active, functional posture. You see, an active, functional posture. Beholding the glory of God, all right, is an active, functional posture. Now, throughout what we call the New Testament, you know, part of the Bible, we would see that active functional posture throughout the New Testament is captured using different words, all right? Different words were used, all right? It was explained in different ways, but you would, regardless of how different words were used to describe that active functional posture, you would nonetheless see repeatedly, all right, the emphasis, all right, emphasis in the epistles, emphasis made on that active functional posture. You see, throughout the New Testament, for example, all right, let me use very popular scriptures that we know. For example, you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Now, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, here was Paul, all right, showing us the distinction that exists between the glory of the law, or the glory that was manifest in the law, and the glory that is manifest in Christ. You see, so he was doing that, you know, from the beginning of that chapter until he enters in the 18th verse, where he now says that we all right, with open face, beholding as in a glass, all right, or as in a mirror, depending on your translation, all right, are being changed. Beholding as in a glass, the glory of God, rather, are being changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. All right? So Paul is saying the same thing. So what Paul is saying here in verse 18, all right, he's capturing for us, all right, an active functional position. So he says, we all right, with open face. Now, with our teaching series where we've looked at that phrase, open face, all right, open face is not just the fact that it's not just your face, all right? We talked about the fact that the word open face, the phrase open face comes from a Greek word, all right, that defines the state of the heart, that captures a heart state. You see, that captures a heart state. So it says, we all, with open face, beholding as in a mirror, you see, beholding as in a mirror, the glory of God, all right, are being changed, all right, into the same glory, into the same image, all right, from glory to glory. You see, now, another scripture that also, you know, captures this is, in a very direct way, is James chapter 1, where James was, you know, distinguishing, all right, or making a distinction between the believer, these two guys are believers, right? Two believers. So he calls one of them a hearer, a believer that is here. He wasn't speaking to the, he wasn't speaking of the guys who is here to awaken to the life of God, all right, whom we generally refer to as the unbelievers. It's not the unbeliever that is a hearer of the word. You see, it's not the unbeliever that he refers to as the hearer of the word. The unbeliever hears nothing, all right? The unbeliever is incapable of hearing. So it is the saved guy, you know, the fellow who has awoken to the life of God that he's describing here as a hearer. So he talks about the one who is a hearer, who in looking into the perfect law of liberty, all right, sees the manner of man that he is. But he straightway, all right, King James says, he straightway forgets. You see, he also looks into the perfect law of liberty, but he says he forgets the manner of man that he is. So the perfect law of liberty presents an image to him, the image of what or who he is. You see? But he says he forgets. But he says the one who is a doer of the word, that is another believer. This one is functional, actively functional. He says that one is the one who also looks, but continues. He does not forget, all right? He does not only look, but he continues. Similar to what the Apostle Paul was saying in 3 of 2 Corinthians, verse 18. He said, we all with open face, beholding, you see, as in a mirror, as through a glass, the glory of God. You see, of course, every part of the epistles, all right, talks about this functional, this active functional state. So when Jesus in chapter 17 of John says that they may behold my glory, that they may behold my glory, he is talking about an experience, all right? He's talking about an experience. He's talking about an experience of his glory from an active functional state. From an active functional state. So the art of beholding his glory isn't automatic. You understand what I mean? It's not just the result of your being saved. You see? All right? You know what I mean by that? It means that now that you are saved, all right, you know, now that you have a relationship, all right, you must remain, you must continue. You see, you must continue, like Jesus says in chapter 15 of John, all right, that his disciples, that is those who love him, they must continue in his word. They must continue in his commandment. You see, this is not just teaching. You see, continuing in his word, in according to John 15, isn't just a teaching. All right? These are just different ways of capturing the same thing. You see, Jesus says in 15 of John, he says, if you love me, you will keep my commandment. You see, the word keep, all right, is active. The word keep is active. Now, these are some of the words we're going to be tying up together. You see, the word keep is active. And the keeping of the commandment isn't just you sitting down and listening to teaching series. Isn't just you sitting down and attending meetings. That is one step forward. You see, the sitting down to hear teachings, all right, is a means to an end. Because some people just hear teachings, all right, the way they interpret keeping the commandment, they just think it's just in hearing teachings, and that's all they do. No, brothers and sisters, sitting down to hear teachings, all right, is one of the steps in the process, all right, in the process of being functional, in the process of being actively functional. Because if you go over into the Old Testament, all right, and we look at the examples of those who had the different levels of understanding they had of what the glory of God was, they didn't just sit down to listen. These folks demonstrated intelligence. They demonstrated skill. Look at the priest, for example, in 2 Chronicles 5. You see, they knew what they were doing. These guys were spiritual guides. You see, they're spiritual guys. Look at Moses. Moses was supposedly in the cloud of glory and yet was asking for the glory of God. This man demonstrated intelligence. Look at David on the other hand. You see, with David, different words were used. But David had active interactions, active interactive penetrations. You see, active interactive penetrations, all right, into the wisdom of God. Hence why he penned down things that stupefies the mind, that causes the natural logic of man to stagger in wonder and awe. You see? So teaching is a means to an end. You see, keeping the commandment isn't just via teaching. You understand? Isn't just via teaching. You see, one of the ends of teaching is that you become functional. Your senses become functional. We can't say this enough. One of the end of teaching is that your senses become functional. Look at Moses. All the while, everyone in the camp, all right, was thinking that Moses, you know, is just a prophet in a class of its own. The man had broken beyond that layer. You see, because he had seen something. Do you understand that? The man had broken. Why Miriam was thinking, you see, Miriam's problem was envy, you know. Does he think he's the only prophet amongst us? I'm also a prophet. All right, Aaron, what do you think? He said, yes, yes, I think I've heard you prophesy a couple of times. So it's true. The last time you gave word of wisdom. So, yeah, you remember that time when I gave a combined, that's when I gave a word that was combination of word of knowledge, word of wisdom, discernment of spirit, and word of, you know. See, yeah, I remember. You know, Glory to God. Don't mind me. Or better still, mind me. You know, they were saying these stuff, thinking these stuff in your head. You know, but you know, that was not Moses' level. At the point Moses was, all right, it was mouth to mouth. It was face to face. That was what God had to help them know. See, every prophet, they were dealing with every prophet, all right, as against the prophetic equipping, as against the prophetic gifting, the prophetic anointing, all right, I deal with them in visions and dreams. Now, the word vision and dreams is a large word. It doesn't just mean the scene of visions and dreams, all right? It is, there are two words used to describe, all right, to describe how the prophetic flows, all right? I've dealt with that, you know, before in the teachings, you know, conference somewhere, you know, prophetic conference somewhere I was invited to, all right? So he says, that's how you deal. That's how, that's the level of interactions of all prophets and prophetic persons. So, but Moses has broken through that. Moses' current level of interactions, all right, is mouth to mouth, is face to face. You see? Mouth to mouth, face to face. Glory to Jesus. Mouth to mouth, face to face. So, when you come over into the New Testament portion of the Bible, you will see that throughout the epistles, we see the spirit of truth, all right, through the ministry gift, all right, by the flow of revelation insight, all right, capturing for us the protocols or the modus operandi for interacting, for actively interacting with the glory of God. We're going to be pointing this out. You see, we see the spirit of truth, all right, through the, you know, the ministry gift, all right, through whom the epistles were written, capturing for us the protocols. You see, the protocols for ascensions. You see, the protocols for engaging and interacting with the glory, you see, the glory of God, the glory of God's state. See, the glory of God's face. Jesus says that is what we are called to do. It's not a choice. He said, all that you have given to me, say, I will, dear Father, that all you've given to me will what? Be with me where I am. So this is not the exclusive right of a few. You see, it's not the exclusive right of a few. See, that's why, you see, it doesn't matter how many years you've been saved. It doesn't matter, you know, how long you've been saved on earth and you leave the earth and go to heaven. You see, when saints get to heaven, all right, they are taught, they take them through the path of learning to function, learning to be where he is. Remember, we looked at this in chapter 14 of John. You see, where I am, he said, after I've gone to prepare a way, John 14, I will come, all right, and receive you to myself so that where I am, you will be also. See, there are believers, all right, who for different reasons, all right, relating to foundations, all right, have not mastered or are not learning how to function, all right, where he is. You understand that? That state and place of divine union. You see, it's interesting because many of the things, or should I better still say, some of the things that we teach, all right, that we teach in the body of Christ, all right, are a contradiction, all right, to where he is. There are some believers who have not been, you know, taught, all right, who, you know, have not been taught and are not living a life, all right, that is based on what? Where he is. They know little or nothing about that state of divine union. Because every other interaction in the kingdom must spring from that place, must flow from that state of divine union. Now, divine union, this state of divine union, all right, are the basis, are the reasons, all right, for teachings on justification, for teachings on the grace of God, for teachings on our righteousness. You see, so that's why when a believer, having supposedly lived out his life on earth, dies, gets to heaven, all right, he must be taught that. He must be, they will expose him to that. He must learn to be where he is. He's supposedly in heaven, right? He's in heaven now, but he will have to learn. Because what Jesus meant when he says in chapter 14, that when I go to prepare a way, I will come and receive you to myself so that where I am, you will be also. He wasn't speaking of heaven. He wasn't talking about heaven. So why some folks we get to heaven and we, you know, begin to rejoice, wow, hallelujah, I've arrived. Say, no, you haven't arrived. You haven't arrived. Glory to God. Oh, glory to Jesus. So he says in chapter 17 of John, all right, he said, I desire, O Heavenly Father, that those whom you have given to me will be with me where I am. See, will be with me where I am. They will be with me where I am. That they may behold my glory. You see? That they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me from before of, thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. You see, that they may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. That they may behold my glory. Glory to Jesus. Oh, glory to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So we are going to be looking at the scriptures, all right, with an end to, you know, as it were, you know, excavating, unraveling this, what we call protocols of ascensions, all right? Protocols of ascensions. We're going to be looking at that, all right? And we're going to be looking at them very closely, all right? Very closely. Very closely. Because in Jesus' words here, all right, what he says about beholding his glory is, you know, shows an active functional interaction. You see, an active functional interaction. And we'll see from other scriptures, all right, in the New Testament, for example, how that all of them, in their references to, you know, what are called as far as beholding and walking in the glory of God is, all right, you will see that they also emphasize that posture, that active, functional, interactive posture. Every one of them. Every one of them. Let's look at chapter 15 of the book of John. All right, John. All right. Just want to show you a couple of scriptures here, verses here. You know, they will begin doing this from tomorrow. All right, chapter 15 of John, verse 1. It says, I am the vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Now, bearing fruit here is not necessarily what many believers think it is. You see, bearing fruit here is not what many believers think it is. For example, on the one hand, some believers immediately go to, their minds immediately go to what? Soul winning. You know, their definition of soul winning. All right, now we all should be involved in reaching out with the gospel of Jesus Christ. All right, we all should be involved in reaching out to the lost. But you see, reaching out to the lost, all right, is not what the scriptures refers to, for example, as the winning of soul. For example, in the book of Proverbs, it says, he that winneth a soul is wise. You see, what was referenced there or referred to there is not evangelism. All right. All right. Another scripture that is popularly used, all right, to encourage us to reach out to the lost, All right. It's also is in the book of Daniel. All right. When that angel is speaking to that, the Daniel says to him that those that turn many to righteousness, those that turn many to righteousness will shine as the stars in the firmament. So that's what we got that those teachings. That some winners, you know, the when you get to heaven, the number of stars you have on your crown, you've heard those teachings, the number of stars you have on your crown, all right, it will be, you know, will be determined by the number of souls. KK wasn't talking about evangelism. All right. Turning many to righteousness, all right, isn't just evangelism. It's not evangelism he was talking about. Are you getting the balance now? We do evangelism, all right? I do evangelism. Everyone should. But that's not what they were talking about. You see, that's what happens. See, when we twist scriptures, all right, when we make scriptures say what is not the original intent, all right, we will not only produce, all right, a false and wrong interpretation, all right, it will stretch beyond that to the point that what, you know, false understanding, all right, false reality, all right, false expectations will also be created. That is why people are thinking when they get to heaven. See, they have the expectation of when to get when they get to heaven. They'll be given a crown with numerous stars. You see that expectation, that false expectation is the product of twisting scriptures. You see? So in 15 here, when Jesus speaks of bearing fruit, he isn't talking about soul winning. Now, I hope you get it. So you don't take what we are saying as, oh, that's why I don't have time for soul winning. No. You know what I mean by the other soul winning? You're not moved with compassion for the lost. No. That you're not moved with compassion for the lost is proof that something is wrong with you, with you, your engagement, your so-called heavenly interactions. You see, to not be moved with compassion for the lost. You see? So hope we get that. So you don't use what we are trying to say here, or what the scripture is saying that we are trying to look at as an excuse for your ineptitude or your complacency, you know, in as far as reaching out to the lost is concerned. No, that's not what we're talking about here. So, but when he speaks of bearing fruit, he isn't talking about, you know, reaching out to the lost. You see, all right, maybe more on that later, but let's just quickly see a couple of these verses. Verse 2 again, it says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. You see, we are going to look at this. For what is this fruit? What is this fruit? We're going to look at in the course of these conversations on the glory of God, all right? Verse 3, now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me and I in you. Now you see, abide in me and I in you. You see, now he is speaking to his disciples. If they don't abide, what else would they do? If abiding is just being around him, that's you don't need to tell them to. But rather, Jesus isn't just speaking about being around him. You see, Jesus isn't just speaking about being saved, you know, and just being in church, you know. This is another way, all right, of pointing to that active, functional, interactive posture. You see, he says, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can you except you abide in me. You see, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me.
All right.
All right. That's not what he's talking about. All right. Glory to God. That's not what he's talking about. So he says, from verse 4 again, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abides in the vine. No more can you, except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abided in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, you see, and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. You see that again? So when it says a man abide not in me, he's not talking about, you know, when you stop believing in Jesus, you know, some people suggest you backslide, you lose your salvation, you know that, lose your salvation, then what? You go to hell. That's not what he's talking about here. You see, this is a kingdom conversation. So, a man not abiding in him and being cast as a branch is not, you know, he dies and goes to hell. That's not what he's talking about here. All right? Verse 7, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it will be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear, we're going to be looking at this. I just wanted to highlight, or I'm going to be looking at this from tomorrow, looking at the protocols of ascensions from tomorrow. All right. He said, herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. You see, that you bear much fruit. So he connects bearing much fruit to being his disciples. All right. So he's connecting being functional, all right, to being disciples. And he says, herein is the Father glorified. Say, God is glorified when what? When the believer is functional. When the believer demonstrates his discipleship, his followership of Jesus by being functional. He said, the Father gets glory from that. You see? The Father gets glory from seeing saints become functional. Now, this is not something we can fully look at now. We're going to be looking at it from time to time, you know, and I'm sorry if, you know, what we're looking at, you know, contradicts what you believed about this chapter and verse, you know. But there's still time to look at it. We'll look at it again. Now look at verse 9. As the Father had loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. 10. If you keep my commandments, you see, if you keep my commandments. So what are these commandments? What are these commandments? You see, now let me just, you know, say this. Now, the commandment Jesus is speaking here isn't just the things that he spoke to the disciples while he was with them. The commandment he's talking about here, all right, is the complete, entire, total revelation of God, all right, in the law and prophets. You see, the commandment is not just the things he said to them for the 3.5 years. You see, the commandment here is the total counsel of God, all right? Is the total revelation of God in Christ, all right? Revealed in the law and prophets. You see? So he says, if you keep my commandment, if you keep my commandment, all right? You shall abide in my love. You see that? Because in the verse before, he has said that the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue, man. How will you continue in his love? How will you continue in his love? Someone says it's by winning more souls, all right? Should we win more souls? Yes. But that's not what he's talking about. Someone says it's by giving more for the cause of the gospel. Should we do that? Yes. But that's not what he's talking about. You see, that's not what he's talking about. All right. So he says, if you keep my commandment, you shall abide in my love. See, so he predicates abiding in his love, all right, on the condition of keeping his commandments. So what are these commandments? What are these commandments? You see, we're going to look at this, all right? So if you keep my commandment, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. You see that? Even as I have kept my Father's commandment. So how did Jesus keep his Father's commandment? Glory to God. All right? Glory to God. Someone says, but the command, I've seen it. Someone says, I've seen it. Where is it? It says in verse 12. Look at verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I loved you. Did you see that? You see what you read? This is my commandment. Look at what verse 10 says. If you keep my commandments, plural. You see? My commandments, plural. All right? Verse 12 is commandments, singular. Now, of course, commandments here is not the 10 laws. No, it's not the 10 commandments. No. Neither is it the 11th commandment. No. 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 Glory to God. Forever. Glory, glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. So we're going to be picking up from here tomorrow. All right? So, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So we're going to be continuing from here tomorrow. The series continues. The conversations continues tomorrow and next week. And, you know, continues. So we're going to be looking at these things and, you know, tracing out and capturing what these protocols of ascensions are. All right? So continue to enjoy the ride. Continue to enjoy what God is doing, all right, right in the middle of these conversations. So until tomorrow, all right, continue to be strong. Continue to be enlarged in your heart by the grace of God and of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Thank you, Pastor.